I'm pleased to advise Eli Eisenberg, who does not need introduction, but since I learned something when he told me that he finished in Bar-Ilan and spent 7 years in Princeton.
I will learn something new.
I always
every day you learn something new.
But if I understand correctly, then you came to Israel and was not in academy, but made some real, real thing. Now you will talk us about the alternative route to complexity, and the continuation is so complex.
Yeah.
So it's clearly very complex. So,
thank you, everybody, for coming to hear about something with such a strange title. I hope by the end of the talk you know what transcriptome and cephalopods are. So, since it's such a remote subject, I want to start with the big picture, the big question that I would like to tackle, and this is the following. There is a process in all animals, basically, which is called RNA editing. This means that there is some enzymatic process in our cells, in the cells of all animals, basically, that enables the cell to modify the sequence of the RNA. So the RNA basically is believed to be, or was believed to be, a copy of the information, genetic information stored in the genome. However, it was found later that this genetic information may be modified in the process going from the DNA to the ribosome to become a protein. And this process is well positioned to allow creating diversity, which is not encoded in the genome. So the same gene, same genetic unit in the DNA can later be modified in various ways to produce many different proteins from the same gene. And of course, this possibility to increase transcriptomic complexity seems very, very nice, very useful. And the big puzzle was, and still is maybe, why is this process so rarely used? So as I will show you, this process exists in all animals. It is used to some extent, but not very often. And the puzzle was why? You have such a useful way to diversify the proteome, to make it, to fine tune it to different conditions and tissues, etc. Why is it so rarely used?
Ellie, can be used in humans too?
It is. It does exist in all animals, including humans.
Yeah, so there is some RNA editing in us too.
Sure.
You must have
edited. Otherwise, the embryo dies very early. Yeah, it's an essential process. If it doesn't happen, the embryo dies shortly before or after birth.
Oh, so it happens in the embryonic stage?
Not only, yeah. Just an example. But
happening in my body now?
Yeah, sure. All over the place. Yeah, it's actually essential. But, okay, so this type of question is usually very difficult to answer because this is a question about something that doesn't happen. So why doesn't editing happen more often? It's difficult to ask because generally, especially in biology, you want to have some model to test what happens if we do have it, if we don't have it, and compare, etc. But here I ask about something that never happens, or at least it was thought to never happen. And now we have a way to tackle this question, at least to have an initial answer, or partial answer. And the theme of this talk, the main idea is that I want to tell you that RNA editing is actually extensively used by a very small but important group of animals, which is the cephalopods, namely octopus, squid, all these nice creatures here below. And they do use editing to diversify their neural proteome quite extensively. And now we can start asking what is the advantages, what are the advantages and disadvantages of this choice. Okay, so cephalopods are not just any group. So here you have a broad picture of the tree of life. You see somewhere here, human, you don't see her. Second, here, yeah. In this small way. And you have the octopus somewhere quite distant from us. But it's not just another group of animals. It is believed to be, based on Wikipedia at least, it's believed to be the most intelligent invertebrate and an important example, some would say the only example, of advanced cognitive evolution in animals other than in mammals. Okay. So maybe even more than mammals, but who knows? Okay. Here's a short example of how cephalopods use tools and can build things. And just remember, this is basically a bag of water. So this doesn't have any skeleton or nothing.
Local shoe.
Right.
Is it a loyal pay of the cashier you made? This should be the ancient perception of the cashier.
Probably not.
That's so fake.
Go to the end of the thought.
That's a brain.
That's a brain.
Then you can't bet in Bergman.
Okay, so you see, I'm sad with this nice.
Okay. So again, this question of the road not taken, I try to tackle it to some extent. I'm sorry? You saw before, it's the size of, well, there are many, many different, the size of a cup, basically. So this was a regular glass cup. But there are some squids that are 1 meter long or even more, and some are tiny. A lot of species in this family. Okay, so first I will tell you in a little bit more detail what is RNA editing. Then I will give a brief description of what is known about the editome in human and other animals, just to give perspective, to compare with cephalopods, and then go to what we found in, about cephalopods and what can be said about the cost-benefit analysis of the choice to use editing extensively, as I mentioned. So the central dogma of molecular biology, the most important thing in biology is the fact that DNA goes to RNA, goes to protein. Namely, the information stored in the DNA is being transcribed, that's the term, transcribed into RNA molecules, which are basically a copy of a section of the DNA, and these are then processed by the ribosome to produce proteins, and everything in our cells basically is done by protein. And there was, a long time ago, some belief that there is a single gene to single protein to single function, so every function in our body is encoded by some gene. Of course, we know today that it's not true. And one of the reasons why this is not true is due to what is called the RNA revolution. So starting about 30 years ago, there was a big change of dogma, and it was understood that the RNA is not just merely taking the information from here to there and doing nothing in the process, but many things can happen in this intermediate stage of the RNA, which can affect the result, and therefore there are many regulation processes that depend on the RNA processing. And well, okay, I don't want to go into all the details, but basically, you see here the central dogma in the late 50s, right? And then about here, there are many, many processes that were discovered that affect the way of the how the RNA is processed and what is the ultimate fate of the molecules that is produced. And it is often said that when the 20th century was the DNA century, this is the second half of it, was the DNA century, and the 21st is believed to be the RNA century. That was before RNA viruses and vaccines came into the headlines. Certainly today.
How is it connected to epigenetics, to the
so this is
of?
Yeah, it's actually epigenetics is a broadly defined term, but you can consider that as a type of epigenetics. If you consider everything that is not encoded in the DNA as the epigenetics, then all the RNA modifications, all the things that happen in the RNA stage are epigenetic. So as you said, there are many RNA modifications, splicing and other things. And you can alter the nucleotide in many ways, but some of them not only change the RNA, for example, splicing just cuts part of the RNA, throws them away, which is one way to modify the RNA, but only a few of them actually change the sequence. You know, the DNA sequence is composed of four letters, A, C, G, T, and RNA editing actually changes one of the letters to another, like spell checking. And that, of course, enables creating multiple proteins from the same gene. And the most common type of editing in metazoa means animals, is the change of adenosine to inosine. So adenosine is the A in the DNA, it's one of the four letters, and using a simple chemical reaction, an enzyme kinds and changes into a fifth letter, which is not normally part of the repertoire in RNA, which is called I, but for most practical purposes and for the purposes of this talk, I will consider I as being G. So it's very similar to G. So basically, you can think of it as a process that changes A into G. And an important thing to remember for the continuation is that the enzymes that catalyze this reaction are called the ADAR, adenosine, the aminase acting on RNA, and a prerequisite for their action is the formation of double-stranded RNA. So DNA is normally double-stranded, it has two strands that are paired together. RNA is normally in our body. It's normally single-stranded. However, sometimes the RNA strand folds on itself and creates this double-strand structure in the in some part of the molecule. And this creation of double-stranded RNA is essential because the enzyme actually binds into double-stranded RNA. This is important to remember. So what is known about 30 years ago, there were first the demonstrations of RNA editing, and all of them were recoding sites. What I mean by recoding? The RNA or the DNA contains parts that encode a protein with some specific code. Every three letters encode some specific amino acid, et cetera, and some other parts that do not encode protein. And if the editing happens in the coding part, it can actually change the amino acid. If it happens in non-coding, it doesn't change. So editing events that change amino acid are called recoding events. And all the first demonstrations of editing were of this type. And the first demonstration was doing insertions in three panosoma. We don't talk about this today. Then C2U in mammals. And then A2I editing was discovered third in 1991. But as I said, this is actually the most abundant type of RNA editing. So let's see a single example. This is the first discovered example. There is some protein called glutamate receptor B. This is one subunit of some receptor in our neurons. And this sequence is shown here, part of the sequence. You see AUG, CAG, and this A in the middle is edited into I. Actually, this happens in all the transcripts, full editing of this transcript. So this single nucleotide change from A to I induces a single amino acid change from T to R. This single amino acid change creates a change of twofold by the permeability of the ion channel. And this is critical. As I said, if this doesn't happen, the embryo dies. You see, one editing event can have a crucial effect. Then more editing events were discovered.
So it's necessary to create both the edited and non-edited, or just...
So in this case, as I said, almost all the transcripts are being edited. And it's a good question, why is it necessary? Why doesn't the DNA encode the correct version? The answer is not really known, but it's a good question. So we have other examples where editing is not true, and maybe we need both versions. It's still not known exactly. Yeah.
The original version found earlier...
So if you talk about this specific example, in all mammals, you have this editing event. When you go to fish, some of them have editing events, some of them have the G encoded in the genome. So it's not clear what was first. And if you go...
The enzyme that carries this out is itself coded in the same DNA on which it acts.
Everything is encoded in DNA.
All the enzymes are encoded in DNA.
So it looks like a very roundabout way of doing it. Coding it directly on an enzyme that will change.
There should be a reason, right? Otherwise, a random mutation that changes A to G in the genome should be superior. In parallel to the discovery of a few examples, there were also some studies trying to understand what is the phenotype, what is the functional meaning of editing. And it was found that the knockout of other one, when you erase this gene completely, there are two enzymes, other one and other two in mammals. So when you knock out the first of them, as I said, the embryo dies. When you knock out the second one, also the embryo dies, but maybe shortly after birth, or not embryo, but maybe one day after birth. This is for mouse, of course. And under-editing is related to different diseases. And there are many different diseases in which alteration of editing was shown, at least in a correlation way. So we know that editing changes in editing are correlated with many diseases, including cancer. So there are some hints that this process is important. And when you go to specific sites, again, I don't want to go through all the list. Specific sites were studied in depth, and it was shown that editing somehow improves or changes or alters the way the protein acts. And I want to focus on this last example, which is interesting for us especially. So different types of octopus were collected from different types of the globe. You see here from the poles and from the Caribbeans, and from warm and cold waters. And it was shown that a specific editing site is correlated with the temperature of the water in which the octopus lives. So cold water, high editing, warm water, low editing. And this was suggested as a hint that editing could confer temperature adaptation. So we have a specific gene which is not optimized to temperature because the octopus can live here and there. And then editing enables fine tuning of the protein to the environmental temperature. Okay, so what, as I mentioned, three examples in the 90s, what happens then? Since the early 2000s, computational methods are introduced to look for editing sites. And the basic idea, I don't have time to go into details, but the basic idea is the following. We have the reference genome here. And let's say we have ample sequencing data. So we sequence the DNA of the animal and the RNA. And we see that the DNA has A here, as it should be, because this is what the genome has. But the RNA, some of them have A, some of them show G. And this is the hallmark of editing. This is quite a naive picture because there are many different processes and conditions and situations that can yield to the same picture. And the big challenge was how to differentiate, and still is, how to differentiate between true editing events and other sites, other things like polymorphisms in the genome, mutations, sequencing errors, whatever. Anyway, computational methods to solve this challenge were developed and resulted in huge lists of RNA editing sites, beginning with thousands and hundreds of thousands, and now we have millions of editing sites discovered in the human and other animal genome. And the surprise was that, unlike the first examples, almost all of these thousands of sites are not coding, are not in the coding part. They're actually in the non-coding part of the genome. Specifically in human, almost all of them lie within something called the allo sequences. What are the allo sequences? So our genome has a specific sequence called allo, which is about 300 bases long, that appears in our genome about 1 million times. So our genome is about 3 billion letters. 10% of that is just 1 million copies of the same thing. Not exact copies, but near copies. And what do they do? There are many things to say about that, but we know that in general, they do not code proteins. And since there are so many of them, as you can see here in the middle, there are so many copies, then just randomly, if you take a gene, there is a high probability that two copies of this repeat will be present there. And if two copies are present in a reverse orientation, like here, one going left to right, one going right to left, then this molecule will fold and create this double-stranded RNA, which is a prerequisite for editing. And that's the reason why repetitive elements in general, and allo specifically, account for most of the editing in human. As I said, this generally does not change the protein. Does it have a functional role? This is still an ongoing debate or question. There are many things to say about that. But when we focus now about coding sequences, about editing that change the amino acid, this should be left out. And okay, let's skip that. And I can tell you that after many, many extensive searches, we now know about 300 sites in the human genome, so not three, but 300, where editing actually changes the amino acid to some extent. And there are also conserved in mammals. So it happens not only in human, but also in some other non-primate mammal, which attests to some conservation, therefore a functional importance. So this cartoon says that the coding activity of editing is a tiny, tiny fraction of everything else that happens in terms of editing. So there's millions of sites edited in non-coded parts, but only a very tiny fraction, this red dot in the middle, represent the conserved site. So this is actually the picture in other mammals too. We see abundant editing in genomic repeats, but very few sites, few hundreds of sites of conserved recoding sites. So recoding is rather rare compared to the ability of the recoding mechanism. And the same thing happens in other organisms, or many organisms we have studied so far, the same picture holds. Repetitive elements are extensively edited. Non-repetitive elements, especially coding sequences, are rarely edited. So we see here a few examples, hundreds of sites per species. So now we go to cephalopods. So why? You saw in the previous slide many, many different species that were studied. Why should we add to this long list cephalopods of all other species? So there are three reasons. First of all, I mentioned before a first study in 2012, I think, about recoding in cephalopods. So it was already known that recoding happens in cephalopods. And in that study, a single gene was studied, not whole transcriptome approach. And in this single gene, they found 50 or 15, depending on the species, editing site in one gene. compared to three that were known for mammals in all the genome. So there was some hint that maybe something interesting happens in these species. They have a lot of editing compared to mammals and other animals that were studied. Secondly, we know that recoding by RNA editing is critical to brain function. I mentioned it very briefly, but editing is associated with neurological pathologies like epilepsy and depression and other things. And therefore, understanding the brain of cephalopods, which is unique, as I mentioned, could be related to understanding their RNA editing, especially as most of our understanding of the basic units of the brain, which is the neuron, is based on the famous Hodgkin-Huxley model from 60 or 70 years ago. And this model was actually built based on results from squid neurons. And it was always assumed that, okay, neuron is a neuron. So we can use this the results of this model to deduce what happens in other brains. But if anything happens in the neuron, and in the squid neuron, and changes everything, maybe this has to be checked again.
Does editing is more frequent in human brains, proteomes than in other cell types?
In brains compared to other cell types? To some extent, yes. So the number of sites is higher in the brain, the total activity is the same. So in other tissues, you have typically few sites that are edited extensively. In the brain, you have a broader range of editing sites. Okay, so again, the goal is to identify patterns like this, where you have genome A, then many different sequences from RNA, some of them A, some of them G, and to discern them from other sources of potential errors. And the general scheme is align everything you have, all the sequences data you have, align it to the reference genome, locate mismatches between DNA and RNA, try some whatever tools you have, statistical modeling, some arbitrary cutoffs, whatever you have, whatever ideas you have, try everything you can to filter out sequencing errors, SNPs, mutations, all the different things that you don't want to include. And maybe depending on the specific task, you can also employ conservation, structural constraints, etc. This is basically the common theme to all the different searches that were done in the past 20 years. And the problem was that, at least at the time when this study started, all these schemes rely on the existence of reference genome, but there was no reference genome for any cephalopod species at that time. So you know that in the past 20 or 30 years, many species have been sequenced, and we have a genome from human, first for bacteria, then for yeast, etc. But no cephalopod genome was available as of 5 years ago, 6 years ago. And therefore, we had to find a way to detect editing without knowing the reference genome. So there is some technique that was developed here to do that. And the next stage was to choose five species of cephalopods, shown here. So two octopus and one squid, one sepia. Nautilus is the distant cousin of cephalopods. And then another outgroup, which is the sea urchin, which is not cephalopod. It's a close relative, a distant relative, but not cephalopod. So for each of these species, we extracted DNA and RNA and sequence. I'm saying we, I didn't do any of that, but my experimental collaborators, and they took these, some of them actually went to the sea and took them out physically, and RNA, DNA, et cetera, prepared all the data, and we put it in our machine, and the bottom line was this. So we looked at the distribution of mismatches between DNA and RNA, or not actually not the DNA, but what we believe to be the DNA, because there was no genome, as I said, and we find the following distribution. So we see that almost all the mismatches found were the type A to G. So in principle, you have 12, there are four letters or 12 types of mismatches possible. And if mismatches occur due to random mutations or sequencing error, et cetera, we expect not really a uniform distribution, but rather flat uniform distribution. And the fact that you find almost all of them to be A to G is a very good indication that our process worked well. And indeed, we filtered out editing events, A to I or A to G events, and all the rest is noise. So you see about 80, 85% of the sites that you found were A to G for all species, not for all species, for the first four species of squid, sepia, and the two octopus. However, the other two species did not show this pattern, and they showed really this flat, or not flat, but a flatter distribution, where A to G, for example, is similar to C to T, G to A, et cetera, as expected. So this means that we believe that this subfamily of cephalopods, meaning squid, tepia, octopus, et cetera, which are called the coleoids, this subfamily has a unique feature that it has extensive RNA editing in the coding sequences, and this does not occur in the Nautilus, which is a cephalopod, and certainly not in the seal, which is not a cephalopod. So we had to validate it. You validate it by one type of sequencing, and then by another type of sequencing, and then more importantly, we validated it in proteomics, which means we looked at the peptides found in these animals and asked, do we find protein peptides that can be there only due to editing? Meaning this peptide is not encoded in the genome. And if we see this peptide, it means that the transcript that preceded it was editing to produce this new peptide.
What is a peptide?
A short fragment of protein. So there is a way.
This is after the DNA was known? After the DNA was known?
Yeah, so the full DNA was not known at this stage, but we had the presumed list of the coding transcript, which we also built. So in principle, you could argue maybe we find peptides that are encoded somewhere else. For that, we had control groups that we find that whatever is not found is really not there. And this is important because it said that not only the RNA is being edited, but actually it's being translated into protein, and new proteins are being synthesized, proteins that are not present in the gene. And also the fraction of peptides found correlated very nicely with the predicted editing level. Okay, so let's assume this is correct. What does it mean? So first of all, in terms of the scope of the phenomenon, more than 50% of the transcripts that are expressed in the neurons of these animals are being edited at least in one place. And this is, you see the comparison to other species like human, mouse, and fly, where the number is minute. So this is not some exceptional phenomenon. This actually happens in most of the proteins. And when you look at pathways, at groups of proteins that do something together, for example, here's some important pathway in the neuron, and we color-coded these different proteins by red, yellow, and green. Red means that it's heavily edited, in many places. Yellow is edited, and green is not edited. And then you can see that almost all, maybe all of the components of this pathway, all the different stages, you don't have to go into the detail of what it does, but at all stages of this process, you see major changes in the ingredients, in the proteins that are. So at least it's clear that there is a potential here to have a big impact on the physiology of the neurons of these animals. So since we have many species, we can now look at conservation, what happens when we compare different species. So we did all these six comparisons between the four animals. And you can see first here that when you compare the two octopus species, which are quite close by, then most of the sites appear in both species, which is a good indication that they are not just random noise. And if you look at rather distant species like squid and sepia, which the evolution distance is estimated to be more than 100 million years ago, it's quite a distance, more than human and mouse, for example. Even you look at such a big distance, a third of the sites are shared, which is a lot. And even farther distant species share more than 10% of the site.
Eli, what is conservable?
The same site is edited in both species. You have a protein, you have the analog protein in the other animal, and the exact same position in the same protein is edited in both. Yeah, thank you. So here's the comparison. So human and mouse have all these three pairs have basically, well, at least in terms of years, have the same evolutionary distance, more or less. And you see the number of shared sites, at least based on what was known a few years ago. So few dozens between human and mouse, few dozens between related species of flies, and 10,000 between squid and sea.
Okay. So you said previously that the structure has something to do with this happens. Now, if you think two species that are very similar, they probably have very similar structure. That part of the DNA, because the DNA are not that big. Maybe, I assume.
No, not really, but I will get back to that. Okay, so remind me.
I'm just wondering if maybe in
species that are very related, but in areas that specifically here, they have different DNA, does the frequency
I will answer this point later, okay? Okay, and not only the fact that the site is edited is conserved, so not only we see editing in the same site, but also the level of editing, meaning the percent of transcripts which are editing is well correlated between different species. So very nice correlation between two octopus, but even here, which is, looks like a mess, we still have a sizable, a reasonable correlation coefficient. So this means that this process is in general conserved, thus presumably important. In order to do it more carefully, we can look for what's called signs for positive selection. Positive selection means that the evolution actually cares about this process and maintains it. So in mammals, it was said, and this is still under debate, it was said at least the non-synonymous event, the event that changed the protein, seems to be depleted. So when you look through evolution, you see that these sites are being erased at some point. And what we see today is just something in transition. At least this was the claim. As I said, it's not obvious, but when we apply the same method to these sites of cephalopods, we see the complete opposite. We see very strong signals for maintenance of editing. And technically, this is done by comparing the conservation of sites that change amino acid to sites that have no effect on the protein, which is called synonymous. And we see that the sites that change amino acid are actually more conserved or appear more strongly, are more strongly edited, whatever measure you want to choose, than these neutral synonymous sites.
What is the horizontal axis?
This is the level editing level. Sorry, I'm missing the axis label here. This is the editing level. So see the weak sites that are edited 0 to 10%, they show no signal, meaning that if the site is edited weakly, it really doesn't matter. But the sites that are edited more strongly, the more strongly you are, then the more conservative. And here there's a big debate still ongoing about what is the role of editing related to expression of UAV. And basically, there are two models that are floating around. And some people say that editing is actually, even if we believe editing is selected, it's actually selected only because the genome prefers to be G. So we have a specific position in the genome that, in principle, it would like to be G. It's better, it's more advantageous to the animal to have the G, but the mutation that does that did not appear yet. So we are waiting. And while we are waiting, editing does the job and change at the RNA level A to G. And this is called the harm-permitting model. So another way to think of it is that you had previously G, then a deleterious mutation came and disrupted the sequence, put there an A where you don't want to A to B, and then editing fixes this deleterious mutation. So this is called harm-permitting model. And alternative model says that editing is actually functional because the fitness of the animal with editing is higher than both the A animal and the G animal. So it's better to have a flexible nucleotide that can be either A or G depending on condition. It's better to have this flexibility as compared to having either A or G. And there is a big discussion about what describes the rarity. And there are many different papers. And recently we showed that at least for cephalopods, we can show that a sizable fraction of sites are actually adaptive in the sense that they prefer to be editing on the two options, so on being either A or G. And then there's some model about that behind that, but I don't have time to go into details. And so I said there are some general signs showing that editing is important, it's conserved, but what does it do? So of course, there are thousands of sites, we cannot study all of them. So here's one example, or two examples. Where, again, not me, but my collaborator took a specific ion channel that is expressed in the neurons of these animals and did some electrophysiology. Just measured the electric response of this electronic unit. And the way this is usually done is you apply some voltage pulse to the unit and measure the current. And, okay. So this is the specific protein. You see here in the black boxes all the editing events that happened there. As you can see there are many of them. We cannot study all the different combinations, of course. So we chose one of them. I'm not sure one. Which one? Maybe. No. So yes, on many different sites. And okay, so this is for one site which is species specific. It appears only in one of the species. And you can see here a small effect on the decay of the current upon applying this voltage pulse. The unedited protein does this. The edited protein, only one editing site now, does a little bit different. And this is typically quantified in this field by what's called tau activation, the relaxation time of the current upon having a pulse. And you can see the inactivation time goes down quite substantially when you look at the edited as compared to the non. So at least at the electronic level, there is a big impact to this editing site. And more
what's the functional?
So that's hard to tell, because this is just one unit in a big complex setup of many different electronic units, and we don't know yet. But right now it's a level of the single unit. A more interesting case is the case of editing sites that appears in all three animals here, squid, CP, and octopus. And you could see here that the unedited version of the three species have quite different behavior for the three species. So that here we measure not the tau inactivation, but the tau off. So how fast the current goes to zero once you shut off the pulse. And you see quite a big difference in these species. However, when you look at the edited version, they converge to more or less the same curve. So here you can imagine that presumably it's better to have some specific behavior, because we're talking about a very basic Basel property of the most basic ingredient in the brain. So presumably there is some correct way to do it. And the spread that you see here in the unedited form is actually bad for the animals. And therefore they edited but they do edit the ion channel and go back to this more or less uniform behavior.
Same animal
will have edited. Yeah, so I showed before, you see here in this case, the editing levels are very high, 80, 70, 89, 98%. So in this case, the majority and maybe almost all versions will have this edited, which is similar.
You give it specifically.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This is in a given condition, at the same time, you will have, let's say, 70% edited and 30% non-edited. And the question whether we benefit from having both together is still open.
70% of nerve cells?
Of the transcript, of the RNA molecule. So within the same cell, within one cell, you have usually multiple copies of RNA. And within the same cell, you have this variability. And of course, there is more variability when you compare different cell types, different tissues.
Earlier, you said something about temperature, adapting to different mm-hmm. temperatures. How is this selected then? What is the connection between adapting to different temperatures?
Well, there is some theory saying that in general, not a theory. It is known that in general, the edited sites tend to encode to smaller amino acids, physically small. And therefore, there is a theory saying that at low temperatures, it's better to have smaller amino acids increase the entropy of the protein. Yeah, so protein folding is based on competition between energy and entropy, of course. And when you change the temperature, the entropy becomes less important, right? And therefore, you want to increase the entropy by using smaller amino acids. That's an idea. It's not really proven yet. Okay. As I mentioned, there are many different editing sites within the same transcript. So we wanted to check what is the combinatorial complexity of this process. So do we have all the different combinations? So we took several examples. And you can see here, for example, one specific transcript that has 8 different editing sites. And we sequenced it quite intensely, quite in depth. And we indeed showed that all 256 different versions, 2^8 versions, do exist in the same specimen. And you see here, in other cases, here we have 9, for example, 9 sites. You don't find all the 512, but close to that, And in some cases, you have 17 editing sites. But then we don't, at least we did not find all the 2^17 versions, but quite a lot of them, quite a lot of versions. So we see that editing does produce combinatorial complexity. So one single gene produces thousands, tens of thousands of different versions. And it's still an open question whether all of them are functional, all of them are used, some of them are used. How does the cell control the distribution between them? This is all still unknown. Our champion is this alpha spectrum, is 247 recording sites. You can imagine what is the number of possible combinations for this single protein that is expressed in the squid
and brain. They all appear in the same specimen.
So at the level of single at the level of
cell.
No. Well, even in a single cell, probably we didn't check in a single cell, but in a single specimen, yes. So in a single specimen, you see evidence for editing for each of the 247. We don't still have evidence to all the 2^247. We will never have, of course. But each of them separately, we have evidence at a single specimen level. Okay, so now to temperature. As I mentioned, editing potentially depends on temperature. There are some theories that I mentioned before briefly that maybe increasing editing is somehow globally better when you are at low temperature. And what we checked and found experimentally now is that when you look at the editing pattern globally, comparing octopus living in cold water and the warm water, 12 and 23 degrees Celsius, we do see a global change in the editing pattern, and the global change is actually directed. So almost all of the sites are edited more strongly in the cold, as expected. You see here on the right. So 20,000 sites show increased editing in the cold. Only, I don't know, 200, 300 showed the reverse direction. So we definitely see a change of editing as a response to temperature. And we now have an ongoing project to understand why this happens. Is this a passive effect of temperature? Maybe when temperature is low, the double strand RNA is more tightly bound, and therefore editing is stronger. Or maybe this is a control process. So editing in cold is good, and therefore there are some other regulators that get involved and responsible for this. And of course, the question is, what is the effect? So do we have can we show clearly that having more editing is better when you live in cold water? This is still open, but we do see a global change in editing in cold compared to warm. Yes? Well, we show that there is more editing in neural tissues. And therefore, most of the study is now being done on neural tissues. So it's a little bit biased. But there is at least some evidence that editing is stronger in neural tissues.
If you move a cold water species to warm water, would the rate change?
Yeah, this actually happened here. So here we took animals grown at some intermediate temperature, I don't remember, and move them to different. This is an important point because the study that I mentioned before in the beginning of the lecture showing the difference between octopus in the Arctic and in the tropic, then we talk about species that live there for generations. Yeah. Here, this is an acclimation effect. You take the same species, move it to different temperature, wait a week or so, and then check. Okay, so now to my back to the big question. So, if editing is so potent, it can increase the diversity and the complexity of the transcriptome of the RNA molecules so immensely, why isn't it more used more in all the species other than these cephalopods? And the model we suggest is the following. I mentioned before that editing by others require double-stranded RNA structure because these enzymes bind to double-stranded RNA structure and they need it to edit. Now, let's say we have an editing event somewhere. This means that there is some local constraint that enable editing, but also this double-stranded RNA in the more distant environment that enables, that is required for editing. And now if I want to maintain this effect, maintain it evolutionary-wise, So many generations come, mutations come and go, and we want to this to maintain there. Evolution has to make sure or has to deplete all the cases where mutations occur such in such a way that disrupts this double-stranded RNA. So as opposed to a normal encoded amino acid, you know, gene DNA, which is encoded by three letters, and then if you insist on this amino acid not to be changed forever, then you need to maintain three letters in the DNA from being mutated, and not even three, actually two, okay? Here, in order to maintain editing, you need to maintain not three letters, but of order of 200 letters, because you need the whole big structure to be maintained to allow editing to be maintained. This was the idea. And we said, okay, if this is the case, we expect to see a higher level of conservation in the vicinity of editing events. And indeed, this is what we found. What you see here basically is the mutation density, how many mutations. Mutations here mean differences between, let's say, squid and sepia, or whatever different pairs you want to check. So what is the average difference in the DNA between the two animals? Someone asked before. So the background level is about 6%. If you take coding sequences of squid and sepia, more or less 6% of the nucleotides are different. However, when you look at the vicinity of recoding site, you see a very nice dip showing an extended conservation of the sequence in the vicinity of the editing event. And this is a very good indication that indeed having an editing event, having a conserved editing event, confers a restriction on the evolution rate in the close vicinity of the site.
What do you mean by the distance from the recording site? Distance in what?
In basically the nucleotide. So the DNA is just a chain of letters, A, C, G, T. Okay. And you have this A that's being edited. So it's saying if you go 10 letters apart.
The recording site is a specific site where you have edited. And you know, if you go one step away from it, then that's already a place where there's no.
Right.
So what is this distance? And this is not a continuous.
It is a continuous. Yeah. It's one polymer.
It's just the address, right?
Yeah, but it's a continuous polymer. It's one long sequence. Well, few of them. But each chromosome is one sequence. And you have in the middle, let's say, an A. And then I go 100 base pairs aside and ask, does this site, 100 base pairs apart from the editing, is it conserved more or less than typical site? Right. And the answer is 100 is, well, more or less here. So it's a little bit less than.
The point here is that even if you go just a few steps away, then it's normal.
No, but the other way around, that we could expect that this dip would be one base pair width. Why? Because only this specific adenosine is important. So this one will be conserved, but when you go three base pairs apart, it will not be conserved. But here you see the opposite. You see that it's conserved to 10, 20, 30 base pairs. There's a wide peak. This is why.
This is not.
I'm sorry?
What is this?
It's proof that in order to maintain editing, you need to maintain the sequence in the vicinity of the site. Not only the site itself, but the vicinity of it. And then we can quantify. Well, a similar thing can be shown with polymorphisms, but now each one of them has some restriction about maybe 10, 20, 30 base pairs, which is not a lot. But since there are so many sites, tens of thousands of them, when you combine all of them, you actually find that this window that I showed you before, this narrow window here, when you combine all the different windows of all sites, you get something about 30% of the coding sequence of the animal is within this window, actually. And you can quantify by integrating this dip, you can quantify how many mutations were depleted in order to maintain editing, and the number is around 10%. Depending on the species. So this is quite a big effect. So genomic evolution is slowed down by 10% in order to maintain editing. This tells us that, first of all, editing is very important. If the genomic evolution is slowed down by 10%, this is probably something very worthwhile to maintain. But also it means that there is a big price for maintaining it, because slowing down evolution has its own price tag.
What is the mechanism of maintaining?
Just normal evolution. Once you have a mutation in the wrong place, this species, this individual will probably be less adapted to its environment or whatever, and we die. The same old mechanism.
Does this happen in frequency and like
junk DNA, how do you call it?
So here we talk
actually
coding. So here we talk only about coding gene. Everything I talk to you in cephalopods is only coding. Non-coding is, let's talk about after. It's a completely different story. Okay, so the main message is that we found genomic rigidity, namely a slowing down of genomic evolution, associated, and we claim that is a result of maintenance of recoding. And this brings me to the summary. So we found thousands of conserved recoding sites in the majority of cephalopod neural proteins. So most proteins that you find in the cell actually are not what is the DNA says. If you take just a random protein, most likely it's not the same as the DNA says. However, or not however, this gives the animal a unique ability, which is not usually used by other animals, a unique ability to fine-tune its proteins, because this process can happen in a different level between different cell types, different developmental stages, different environments, temperature, whatever you want. So we have an opportunity here for fine-tuning, which seems like a very good thing to have, and the combinatorial capacity for diversification, as I showed before. However, this proteomic plasticity comes at a price, and the price is a slowdown of genome evolution, as we just described. So we can actually show it on this cartoon. The parts of the DNA that have a lot of recoding events, this left and right, have a slowed genomic evolution, and vice versa. So this is a trade-off here. And we can think of it as cephalopods taking an alternate route to complexity. So unlike other animals, including us, they chose, or whatever, adapted to use recoding extensively, paying the price of slowdown genomic evolution. And now we can start thinking of what are the pros and cons of that. So, for example, maybe cephalopods live a very short lifespan because they don't have genomic evolution or whatever. I mean, this is still something to be checked, of course. But now we have a handle to start thinking about the pros and cons and the benefits and cost analysis of having extensive recoding. So maybe this has made all the difference, who knows? So let me just finish and thank the students who did most of the computational work here, Shachar, Noah, and Ruti, and Yoav, and my collaborator, my experimental collaborator, Joshua from MBL, Marine Biology Lab, and the collaborators from Bar-Ilan. And thank you very much.
So can you say the evolution history of the cephalopod that they evolve less because of that? Yeah. So you have a prediction that they would evolve less than...
Yeah.
The question is whether it's large enough to see the effects.
So what does it mean to evolve less?
So less species, or I don't know, in the tree, in the family tree. Or...
So plural species are not necessarily mean less evolution. But the most direct way to measure if they evolve less is to quantify the number of mutations, which is exactly what we did. So the question now is, does this effect have a functional effect? So this is a very difficult question to answer.
I want to ask you, if you look at the fossil record, the different types of cephalopods, millions of years back.
Yeah. So personally, I don't think this is a good proxy, but if you just raise it, so I would say, if you look at fossils of the cephalopods, they look just the same as current day.
They actually show less diversity.
Well, I don't believe that looking at the external shape of an animal from fossils and comparing to current day shape is really a very good measure of brain development, for example. But as far as this goes, cephalopods are basically the same way, roughly speaking, as they were 500 million years ago.
Ben.
But one thing this has nothing to do with embryonic cell differentiation. Is it like a stem cell, say an embryo, develop differently depending where it is in the embryo? Mm-hmm. Have you at all connected to this?
Yeah,
those are cells with identical genomes.
Yeah, we don't know, but it is possible that different cell lineages within the embryo have different levels of editing. It is possible. Not much is known about this yet. Not even in mammals, certainly not in cephalopods.
So this is why cats have white feet?
But we do know that the editing pattern in embryos, in mammals, is different than adults. So the editing pattern in embryos, in mouse embryos, is different than adult mouse. So there is some tweaking of the editome along the developmental path. Does it, what is the functional effect of that? Nobody really knows.
And the ending will actually end at some point in the development.
Yeah.
I'm not. Also tell to me what technical tools you used for this research, and in particular, where was your training as a physicist relevant to this research?
Yeah. Okay. So the first one is simply to answer. I didn't go into the details, but basically the challenge I briefly mentioned is when you get maybe this is better. Yeah. So we send a species to sequencing, we get billions of such sequences. And then the challenge is how to take this huge data set, which has a lot of sequencing errors and other errors and whatever noise, and discern from this the signal. This is the challenge. And the way to do that is try to understand how to model the different sources of error, so to speak. Some of them are not really errors. Some of them are other biological processes that give something that's similar to editing. But you have to understand all the different sources of error to model them properly and to apply statistical tools and modeling, whatever, to try to find the signal out of the noise. So if you just look at raw data, this signal is maybe four orders of magnitude lower than the noise. So there is some modeling and needed to be done in order to find this thing. This is the challenge. How is this related to physics? Well, I don't really know, but I think, broadly speaking, I think the way of looking at how to model things and is relevant, and how to understand signal from noise, how to analyze experimental data. But I don't really have a better answer.
Yes.
Is it correct to conclude from what you showed us that there are two different routes to diversification, large N, non-microscopic, the genome, the change in the DNA, or editing of the RNA? And only two.
No. So, okay. So, first of all, I wouldn't call genomic mutation a way for the diversification, because once you mutate the DNA, you have only the mutated version, but only the mutated version. So you don't have both. This is unlike any, well, we have, you can have, but basically mutation, you have only either the old version or the new version, but you don't have both. So this is not really diversification. Editing gives really diversification. If you're having the same animal, the same cell, both versions. So that's one comment. The second is, of course, there are many other ways to achieve complexity. People speak about splicing, and I mentioned you can take a RNA and cut it in different ways, creating many different combinations. There are complexity. There's a way to achieve complexity by different interactions between proteins. So you can combine different proteins in different ways and create combinatorial complexity. There are many different ways. For the purpose of this talk, I focused on the ones that are important to me. But of course, there are many ways. But still, I think that the fact that there is a mechanism that is naturally creates complexity, and it's already there. You don't have to invent it. It's already in ourselves, and it's functional. But still, it's not used. I think this was a big puzzle. Why is it not used more extensively? And maybe this is part of that.
Not used extensively in the editing.
Mm-hmm.
In mammals.
In mammals.
Okay, so I think
thank you.